think I am the object of an Iranian attack against the Arabs. And I mean, because in the Arab world, you never put poets and non-poets. Now I am completely in a dream and I cannot focus on what I was because I was in this wonderful poetry thing. And I just, maybe before I read from my book, I want to say something about, for me this is 1001 Nights, really. And one reason I was sitting there and I was saying, way in Morocco, I cannot have a panel where there is an American, Grenadian, and an Iranian, because it's too expensive for us. So you don't realize one of the things I keep repeating while I'm here, this sense of wonderfulness is the diversity there is in America. I mean, anywhere I go, the panels are so diverse, and you take it for granted. This is really wonderful and luxury. And then I want to read this verse, this Quranic verse I like very much, where the diversity of languages and colors is, in the Quran, a miracle. And this verse, Surah al-Rum, the Surah of the Romans, and it's verse 22, so that you don't waste time looking. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Among his miracles, he created the sky and the earth. وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ. And the diversity of your languages. وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ. And the diversity of your colors. And one thing about trip. We are lucky, I'm so lucky to travel and to participate in these encounters. And just about the word safar, Arabic word for travel, safari, you know safari. It's the Arabic word. It means to put the mask down, to discover yourself by confronting, of course, the diversity. وَسُمِّي السَّفَرُ سَفَرًا لِأَيْنَهُ يُسْفِرُ عَنْ وُجُوهِ الْمُسَافِرِينَ وَأَخْلَاقِهِمْ. The trip was called trip. It's unveiling because it unveils the real ethics of the people. That is, you discover it by discovering, by confronting the difference. Okay, this just to come now from my poetic enchantment. I read from my chapter 12, Princess Nur Jahan. The idea of the harem woman, Saba, is she is passive, she is beaten up, she is stupid, the politicians manipulate her. Well, I mean, she is not a harem woman, but in Iran, when the Ayatollah decided to veil women, the idea is really to make them play. Veil is about theater. Yes, you transform the whole country into theater. Because in Islam, woman is intelligent, and it's a power which is totally uncontrollable. And when she was talking, it was just a very good, when Goli was talking about her experience as an Iranian writer, that was just a fantastic example of how incontrollable it is to try to control women or to censor them. And now, but one of the things about Islam is that you grow up with this diversity, and I always dreamt, you know, of going to Asia and so on, but never would I have imagined something like the Queen Nur Jahan, who is Mughal dynasty. The Mughal dynasty are Mongol and Turkish mix from Central Asia, actually, actual Bukhara and Samarkand, but they ruled India. And the Queen Nur Jahan is incredible. Nur Jahan, I mean, this is a Harem woman. Nur Jahan, light of the world, was born Nur Mahal, light of the place. But the first thing she did after marrying Emperor Jahangir in 1611 was to change her name. Who wants to go to be light of the place? She can be light of the world. She also wanted everyone to know that her favorite pastime was hunting tigers, of which she killed many, competing with the best in the field. Needless to say, when I started reading about Nur Jahan and talking with my colleagues at Morocco University, I was saying, Fatema, I gave you up creating stories because you don't know much about Asian Islam in Morocco. Unfortunately, it's not taught in the schools. You only discover it as an adult. During her time on the throne, Nur Jahan gained a reputation as a superb markswoman, surpassing even Mirza Rustam, Jahangir's best shot in the killing of the tigers. One of Nur Jahan's assets was her age. She was not a young and blushing virgin when she married Jahangir in 1611, but a 34 years old widow whose husband, a dignitary who had held a post in Bengal, had died under mysterious circumstances. His death was suspicious because everyone knew that Jahangir loved Nur Jahan since childhood. Now I'm quoting. After the unexplained death of this embarrassing husband, she returned to the heart of the imperial court and married Jahangir a few months later. Another unusual detail was that Nur Jahan was a foreigner in India. She was a Persian, as such, a Shiite from Shia, not Orthodox Islam, not Sunni. To marry Jahangir, who like most Mughal rulers belonged to a Sunni Orthodox dynasty, was like sliding into a minefield. Yet, Nur Jahan was clever enough to create a Shia lobby within the court by placing men of her family in key positions. She surrounded herself with a clan comprising, among others, her father, Etimaduddaulah, a Persian adventurer who had become Jahangir's prime minister, and her brother, Asad Khan. But Nur Jahan had, if Nur Jahan had been merely a sportswoman or an astute Harem lady who surrounded herself with men of her clan, she wouldn't have the extraordinary impact that she has had on the Islamic cultural scene in general and on the arts in particular. She also had a flair for public relations on two distinct levels. I really like her. She was also a businesswoman, which is something I'm very bad at. First, she stepped directly into the artist's studio and negotiated new ways of representing women, love, and conjugal intimacy in art. By appearing beside her imperial husband at events she initiated. Second, she became involved as an art collector, thus indirectly influencing fashion and taste. Quote, we know that Mughal influencing fashion, we know that Mughal women of the noble class and imperial family were considerable traders, running their own boats and developing their own list of commodities, and that of them, the two most illustrated were Jahangir's mother, Maryam al-Zaman, and Nur Jahan. Nur Jahan's influence as an aggressive trader was so well known in diplomatic circles that between 1617 and 1618, she was even appointed protectress of the British embassy. But before leaving Nur Jahan behind in the 17th century, I was tempted to ask the following question. Did Muslim history remember this incredibly subversive queen? To answer this question by myself would have taken hours or even days at the noisy and stuffy Rabat Mohammed V University library. But as an Arab woman, I have at least one advantage over men. If the Arab woman has an advantage over men, if she calls an Islamic expert in fields such as history or Sharia, religious law, and ask him for help, of course you have to look around him. Tradition decrees that he provide her with the requested information. The Sharia expert that I usually call contact often, show me the relevant pages in his own book, and even lets me borrow them for a few days so that I can copy them. This is a dangerous thing because in Morocco you don't borrow books because you never see them again. So I made few phone calls, and within a few days was told about Omar Kahala's portrayal of Nur Jahan. As recently as 1955, I learned Omar Kahala, an Egyptian scholar of Turkish origin, gave to Muslim women a fantastic gift, 5 volumes containing hundreds of profiles of the titled Women Celebrities in the Arab and Muslim World. Should what I mean? I stopped in 5. Nur Jahan, of course, is on the list, and Omar's description of her, which barely mentions her emperor husbands, makes Shahrazad's princess look miserably limited. I called him. She was an Indian queen, had grace and beauty, he writes. She knew both Persian and Arabic and had a perfect knowledge of both cultures. She was accomplished in music and other sophisticated arts, al-adab al-rafi'. She managed her kingdom, in a perfectly rational manner, set taxes, and examined closely the country's daily affairs. Now, I have to tell you, Jahangir was into drinking. She used to appear at a window of the palace to display herself to the kingdom's princes and to review armies' parades. Money was coined in her name, which appeared together with that of her husband. It was reported that she used to go hunting with other women of her palace and that they rode the fastest of horses just like men. Now, this is a harem woman, and the Western man represents harem women, as you know, in the Odalisque, in Matisse, and also in Hollywood films. There are these little darlings with just a soutien and a skirt dancing and nothing on the brain. Merci.